So today I'm talking about forking, threading, multiprocessor option in Perl, which is kind of obvious. Can I just have a hands up? Who's even tried to do multiprocessing stuff in Perl? Okay, excellent. You're going to have some great questions for me that I won't be able to answer. So why should I care? Perl's a great language. You can do lots of things in it. If you want to process things individually, it can be fairly trivial, depending on the challenge you've got. What about the cases where you've got an awful lot of data you're working with, or something where you've got lots and lots of network lag, such as fetching hostname for an IP address or a web page from the internet? Or you have a large amount of expensive analysis. Perhaps you want to run thousands of regular expressions over a set of data. You can absolutely do them in a naive way. Take my large list of things, process them individually. But if your very big list is very, very big, and you are processing them individually, and your processing function is expensive, then you're going to run into problems where your machine is quite happily working away, keeping one CPU very, very busy. And the rest of your machine is like, hey, I'll update the time. Another clock tick there, yep, that was very exciting. So this can be a fairly ineffective way, an inefficient way of running your program. And here's an example of what your expensive process thing might be. So here we take our item, we fetch a URL. There would be error handling in here. Just pretend it's there for the simplicity of this example. And then we're looking for a certain match of regular expressions. Does this regular expression match that page? If so, keep the first two things that were captured in the parentheses. It's actually interesting to determine what would be the most expensive here. Without actually having a good idea of what our data is, we can't say, yes, that regular expression thing is going to eat up most of our time. Or yes, we're going to need to worry about a lot of network lag. We need to know a bit more about our data. And that's something you get the fun of playing with. Now, the two main options for multiprocessing in Perl are kind of obvious: forking, the title of my talk, and threading. These both have a lot of similarity and a lot of differences. In both cases, they start a new child process. In both cases, each process gets a full copy of the Perl interpreter. It gets a brand new Perl interpreter just for itself. So they are actually fully new processes. In both cases, they also get a copy of the data that the parent spawning process had. Not entirely true. I'll get back onto that. So for forking, whole new process. They're fast, they're reliable. Many, many years of Unix forking semantics, your studded out and studded error and environment are inherited. The new process runs and it is typically unaware of the existence of the parent process beyond those file handles in the environment. And it doesn't typically talk to the parent process. You can do that. There are ways to get around that. A lot of the Unix-like operating systems have a wonderful optimization here called copy on write, which means that when the process spawns, it merely basically gets a reference to the parent's page. It runs through memory pages. It works with those, and only if it should actually need to change something does it actually take its own copy. Which means that if you load 100 different modules in your Perl script before you even fork, that's fine. You don't need to have loaded them again. If you read a 1 gigabyte file and fill your memory with it, and then you want your forked process to do something with it, that's fine. You're not taking a second copy. Probably slow down your machine regardless, though. Threading, again, a whole new process. It gives you extra cool stuff. You can have shared variables, and you can use semaphores to signal, hey, I'm doing this, or hey, I'm doing that. You can say, hey, I'm going to yield. I think I've done enough processing for a moment. Does anyone else want to do some processing? But it's very memory hungry. Unlike forking, it doesn't do copy on write. It gets a full copy of the parent's pages right up the front. And you do this for every single thread you create. So you need to do a little bit of clever footwork to minimize how much preloading of stuff you've gathered that the forks will not need. Threads can be aware of their siblings and their parent because they get these opportunities to share variables and talk to each other. So they can work together to solve through things. Before I go a little bit further into it, we need to think about scaling. We don't want to hammer our machine. We don't want something that looks like this. And we don't want something that looks like this. Both of those will rapidly cause us to run out of resources. Things we take into account are the number of CPUs we have or have access to, and the amount of CPU versus network use our program's going to have. So if we go back to the example I had before, we would need to have an idea of this data. Is it going to be more expensive on the CPU, or is it going to be more expensive on the network? If it's going to be more expensive on the CPU, then we probably want to have CPU minus one as our maximum number of processors. If it's going to be much more hungry for network, because maybe we typically only have one or two regular expressions there in our at items finds, then you might want to have 10 to 20 times the number of CPUs you have. Adjust to fit. But network lag is very, very slow. So you can have more processes going because they'll all just run and say, fetch that, wait, wait. And another one will come along and say, fetch that. So one of the solutions that I'd like to present, and there are a few other solutions and I'll mention those at the end of each section. One of the solutions I've used quite heavily this year has been Parallel Fork Manager. As implied by the name, this is one of our methods using fork. This makes, in my opinion, forking quite easy. You could do your own work, just have fork and check your return values, but this one I think makes it much, much sweeter. So this is essentially solving that same for each loop I had at the start. For each, all the items in my very large list, call process on them, gather the results. So starting off, we create our fork manager object. And we give it our maximum number of forks. That will be typically what you decided on before was your maximum number based on CPU, network use, anything else that might apply here. If you set this too high, your machine will be hammered, you'll have a load over 100. Maybe that's okay. Usually it slows your machine down. You probably want to stick it about a load of 80 or so. We can set callbacks through Fork Manager to handle certain things when a child process finishes. So in this case, run on finish allows us to gather access information to the process ID our child had, its exit code, any identifier, the signal that killed it, if a signal killed it, whether or not it dumped core. And the most interesting one, as far as I'm concerned, is the data structure it returned. So children can return data structures and we can unpack them. So then say if I have a result and it is a reference, then hopefully it's an array, push that onto our array. Again, there are ways that you might want to go to do more error checking here. For example, checking that DS is not undef to start with. Fortunately, the situation where your child would finish cleanly and you've correctly called finish and you not get your data structure are few and far between. So once we've got that, we can process our items. For each my item for my list, start. PM goes to start, just says, do that fork. Create this new child process. It returns a true value to the parent and a false value to the child. So the parent's like, okay, yep, and it skips on to the rest of the loop. The child then continues to run until finished is called. If you forget finish, it will continue running and attempting to run the rest of your script, so you probably don't want to do that. Typically, you would then call a subroutine or something like that, which is essentially what we're doing here. So we do our processing as per normal. We wouldn't even need to, and then we've got our results from our processing, and we pass those back when we call finish. This is my return value, we are essentially saying. And the main process has to wait for its children to die, because the moment the main process terminates, it quite happily kills all of its children as well. Which is sort of what you'd expect. I mean, if we think about just regular bash, if you've got a script running and you kill your bash window, you didn't happen to have screen running in it, your process is going to die. Exactly the same thing here. If your Perl program terminates, all of its children programs terminate too. Don't call exit within a thread. You get exactly what you think you'll get, which is not what you want. So regardless of how many items we have in our very large list here, we're only ever going to have the maximum number of forks that we told the process manager it can have. So it will block on that call to start if you've already used your maximum number of threads for the moment, or forks for the moment. So that's handy. It does that management for you. This is, again, what we had before. You can see that the parallel forked version requires a little bit more code. Not a dramatic more, but we'd get a many-fold increase in speed. And that's pretty awesome. So, are they gotchas? Absolutely. Child processes get their very own copy of their parent's memory, as I said. Now, this means we would not get a compile time error if we had tried to push those results onto the array that our parent had defined at results. It just wouldn't work, because all the child stuff would get cleaned up and thrown away when it finished, and would be like, where are our results? I made this change. I'm embarrassed to say how long it took me to work that one out. So just as we can't change our parents' shell environment from inside our code, strangely enough, the children can't change their parents' stuff, variables or whatever, from inside themselves. Which is why we have to call finish. Finish finishes the thread, says, yep, I'm done. The first value is the exit value. Yep, 0 for success. Excuse me. And then we pass our data structure, in this case, our results to an array reference. So, no communication. As I said, naively, threaded programs can't talk amongst themselves. They are not working on a shared problem. There is no shared queue. They just get the job their parents give them, and then they run off and do things. Yes?
Quick question. Do you know how the fork manager passes the results back to the parent? Why?
It's deep and dark and scary code that I looked at and went, yeah, that's good. I'm going to leave it there alone now.
Okay.
Actually, I think it's through sockets, but beyond that, I'm not entirely certain. It is pretty sweet, though. So, yes, there are no communications. The parent can't say, hey, child, just finish up. You can wrap a timeout or an alarm around it, but you can't. The parent can't say, no, you're taking too long. The parent can't say, oh, while you're at it, turn debug on. I'm not getting enough data from you. The parents don't get, they just spawn the child and the child runs off and does things and then it finishes. Likewise, a child process doesn't know that the other child processes exist, or how many other processes exist, unless you use a database or a cache or some other way of sending this information to each other, files on the file system. And of course, if you do that, locking is very important. So system file locks, database locks, something to make sure that they don't swamp each other. Do not allow more than one of your children to be changing a file at the same time. This really should be obvious. It's very exciting when you get it wrong. Database handles are not shared. They never are. This is not just forks. This is a problem with threads as well. Overall, it's some people say, well, don't do SQL with threads and forks. It's easy. Just clone your database handle, the one your parent had. Clone it, you're fine. Go forth and absolutely hammer that database until your sysadmin gets unhappy with you. Okay, there are strengths. As I said before, forks are fast, at least on Unix-like machines. A little slower on Windows. They're quick to start up. They get copy on write if it's a Unix-like machine, particularly the Linuxes. There might be a Unix-like machine operating system that doesn't do this, but I couldn't find one. I didn't search exhaustively. I don't know about VMS, for example. So the only penalty that they incur is the time and memory required to duplicate the parents' page tables. which is pretty small. And of course, create a unique task structure for that child. Again, not a big thing. When the page is written, so when the memory page is written to, then the child takes a copy of it, its own special unique copy. But for a lot of the time, you're going to be reading stuff. You're going to be reading the code from the modules that your parent has inherited. You're going to be reading all those kind of things. Fork on an operating system that implements copy on write, most memory efficient solution for multi-process coding. Oh, and a really big plus, you don't need to recompile Perl. Perl only works with threads if it's compiled for threads, which seems kind of obvious when you say it that way. But if you're like, hey, I just want to do this test at midnight, why isn't it working? Now you know why. So, are there any alternatives to Perl Fork Manager? Absolutely. Child.pm, beautiful solution, even provides some basic IPC capabilities so the parents can talk to the children and sort of vice versa, sort of. Again, the children don't tend to know about each other, but they can still run off and do things asynchronously, and that works really well. This should be a lowercase f, but clearly my editor doesn't love me. Forks.pm is another alternative. It's actually a drop-in replacement for threads.pm, which I'm about to talk about in a moment. So it basically implements the whole threading interface via forks underneath, which is kind of neat. So let's talk about threads. Okay. Now, I've changed the structure of how this works a little bit because it would be unfair to show a threads example which doesn't take advantage of queues. The type of work we have where we have a very large list of things and we want to pull something off and work on it is inherently a queue structure. And if I were to just show you a threads example with a for each loop doing a processing in the middle, that would not be a fair example of what threads can do. So the structure is slightly different, but I think you'll understand. So we start off and we create a queue. Now we don't populate the queue before we give it to the threads because we don't want the threads to have all of the data. We want them to get an item off each time. And if we gave them all of the data to start with, then they would get an item off their private queues and they would all do the same work. So we create an empty queue. Then for each of my threads that I want to have, and this is just a way of limiting, so we're not doing that while one create new thread, create my thread and push it onto an array of threads. I don't strictly need to, but if I want to be able to talk to the child threads later, I need to store them somewhere. So in this case, I'm storing them in an array. Context list says I expect when I call the finalize function for the thread that I want to get a list context back. Then I pass it my array reference. My subroutine reference. This is the code I want you to do. And in my case, of course, the data queue, which is empty. When I have created my threads, they're off running, they're trying to pull things off that queue, which is currently empty. Then I put a whole bunch of things onto that queue. Further in my code, I am going to walk through over all of my threads and I'm going to say join. Join basically says to the thread, finish up now, and it blocks. So it'll go to the first thread and it will say, right, okay, when you've got data, give it to me. And then it'll just wait. And when the data finally comes through, it'll be like, yep, okay, and it'll go call join on the second one, which is probably finished by then if your threads have roughly the same runtime. You can actually detach threads and say, just finish when you finish, but you still can't kill your program before they're dead. So you still need to do something that means you wait around long enough before they die. This is the do process here is what I actually call to do the process function. And it's grabbing an item from the queue and calling process, just like my regular loop before. However, we've got a while here, it's like, while I can get items off the queue. So rather than creating a new fork for every single item, which is what we were doing previously, here we are creating, we are creating a minimum number of threads and reusing them to go through that data. The main reason we do this is because of memory. As previously discussed, threads get the whole copy of their parents' memory. What you may also know is when Perl gets memory, when Perl asks for an allocation of memory, it never gives it back until termination. So you've got these multiple threads, all with their own copy of all their parents' data. If you start, let's say you want to hover around four threads, but you somehow manage to create five or six to start with, you're going to have, and then even if you get down to four again, you're going to have these extra two threads worth of memory just being kept by Perl in case you need it again later. This can make threads incredibly expensive memory-wise and potentially untenable in certain situations. So we prefer threads that start up and then just run doing their task again and again. Threads allow us to have shared variables, and this is pretty cool, mostly. So let's say we wanted to take an approach where our results queue was shared. So instead of threads packaging up all of their results and then returning them upon our call to join, let's have them edit our array directly. So we use our thread shared and we mark our results as shared. Down here, we can just work with them straight away. So we get our results from calling process, we lock our results, that's the shared results, and we push onto it. The lock goes away at the end of scope, so we're not keeping a lock on it indefinitely. If we don't lock this, then we could potentially run into race conditions. Where, and less so in this example, but if you were looping over something doing an increment, or you were reading a value and then like $A equals $A plus one, or something like that, there were all of these situations where you could get, I read it and it was five, and I incremented five plus one is six, and I put six in there, except something else has read it and already, now it's seven, so I've just overwritten seven with five. You can get all those sorts of problems. Here, when we're doing a push, push is not strictly atomic, but it's good enough that our results might end up like this, but that might be okay, especially since we're just throwing results in any way we want. Still, something to keep an eye on. Always lock your variables if you're sharing them. Oh, and this, of course, means deadlocks. If you make it possible for process A to lock this variable and that variable, and process B to lock the second variable and the first variable, then they can both lock one to start with, and then not be able to get the lock on the others, and your program will wait forever. It's a known problem. There is so much documentation on how to avoid deadlocks and to think about deadlocks and race conditions, but the things to keep in mind. Now, in this example, I hope someone, at least someone in this room, is thinking that's not the right solution. Pushing stuff onto your parents' array is also not the right solution. You should totally be using an output queue, and you should be. So this is how we'll do it with an output queue. So here we go, we've created our output queue. We create our child processes as we did before. I'm not passing in list context anymore because we're not going to be calling them in list context. I queue just as I did before. And now the parent process, which is typically called the main thread, now the parent process does something. It says, while I can get things out of the output queue, do something with that result. So the process was the child processes, the threads, will start. They'll get something out of the queue. They'll process it. They'll push it onto the queue. The parent queue will pull it off and do stuff. It's great, our parent process. So here we have our do process, and we're pushing onto out queue. We're using in queue. Put this on the queue. Fairly straightforward. I love that we can do it that way. We can queue these things up here and queue those things, and children can put things back on the main on the first queue, and then the next child might pull them off, and it's easy and straightforward and scary as heck. Interpreter threads can also include semaphores, conditional waits, the ability to yield to other processes. The main thread can see what threads are running. I don't have time to cover that, and I know that you're all starving hungry, so I'm going to keep moving on and tell you a couple of gotchas. This is the biggest one. This one made me cry. As of about May 2014, just a few months ago, threads and the threads module were officially discouraged. Mostly because, as it says, few people know how to use them correctly and will be able to help you. Now, discouraged is not deprecated. If we can come up with a solution, we might be allowed to keep them. But currently, they're officially discouraged. A couple of other pitfalls. The big one, you have to recompile your, you may need to recompile Perl, and if you need to recompile Perl, you need to recompile all of your XS modules. And knowing how much people loved moving from Perl 5.6 to Perl 5.8 because they had to recompile everything, I could tell that you're all excited about that one. So, your system Perl might not let you use threads, and your sysadmin might not let you either. You might not be allowed to have more than one version of Perl, even with Perl Brew. So that's a bit of a drawback. And then some modules, including potentially some standard in-core modules, might not be thread safe anyway. For example, any module that uses fork is not thread safe. Furthermore, modules, so class inside out, no longer the bee's knees of OO in Perl, but a few years ago, class inside out had this wonderful idea of lightweight objects stored all of the data in arrays and stuff inside the class itself rather than in the object you're passing around. Flyweight objects, very cool, totally not thread safe for a little while. And then someone was like, oh, I could totally fix that. And they did, and it's great. But anything that's doing cool stuff with memory and all of that might need to change the module, or you might need to not use it because of the issues when you copy memory, you copy your parents' pages. Threads can be slow and memory hungry. I've kind of suggested this already. You need to inherit the smallest footprint as possible, which may mean you create all your threads and then you use your modules, except you can't use because that happens at compile time. So you either need to wrap your threads in a begin block or you need to do a require and then import, all of which is ugly and nobody loves that very much. So some alternatives. The best alternative I could find was forks. Again, that should have been a lowercase f. Forks.pm is a drop-in replacement for threads.pm. So instead of saying use threads, you say use forks. And then everything else works exactly the way you expect. And it does forking underneath instead of threading, which of course means that you don't have to recompile your version of Perl. You get all those shared objects. There are a couple of gotchas around semaphores, but if you're not using those, it's okay. And you get the queues, and all that works nicely. And my favorite thing about this is that it uses Acme DAM as a core required module. Now, you probably all know that things in the Acme namespace are not supposed to be used as core required modules. But this one's awesome, because what Acme DAM does is it allows you to unbless an object. So you take your array reference and you bless it into class, I don't know, something. And then you can use Acme DAM to unbless it out of that class and back to an array reference. And that's one of the things that forks.pm uses so that it can cheat and pretend to be threads. I thought it was pretty cool. So in conclusion, because I'm sure we're all eager to get out there, multi-process code is great. Forks are still the way to go, sadly, because threads are now unloved again. And if you want to talk to me about the history of how unloved Perl's threads are, like, excellent idea, unloved. Excellent idea, unloved. We could talk about that at lunchtime. Any questions? Yes?
POE?
POE?
I've always discarded it.
I can't really... I can't really say anything good about that.
No, that's fine. That's all I wanted to know.
Any other questions? Yes?
You mentioned that using forks.bm instead of threads.bm, semaphores have some issues. I'm just wondering why that is. Are they not implemented as standard 6.5 semaphores under the hood?
Okay, so I'm going to repeat your question so the video can hear that. I mentioned that forks is a drop-in replacement for threads, but semaphores have some issues. Why aren't they using the system 5?
No, I'm just wondering whether they aren't.
Are they using semaphores under system 5? I can't... So most of the way that forks the module succeeds in replacing... So achieving all of the communication between this is through sockets, which makes sense and is it's a little bit slower. There are times when threads shared, the default would be faster than using sockets to do your inter-process communication. But I'm not quite sure I understood. I mean, I know I didn't understand why semaphores were occasionally problematic. I read through the documentation. It looks like most of them are fixed. It's just that they are not, I think the main problem is that they are not entirely compatible, 100% compatible with the way semaphores were done under the threads module. But they do work. And they probably are using that underneath. I didn't look at the code, I'm afraid. Oh, not that bit anyway. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you very much.